Taylor recognized something that I think would be helpful for us to recognize as we approach this great, grand, and glorious passage this morning found in the Gospel of John. And that is simply this, my sisters and my brothers, that the answer to every question that haunts and plagues humanity can be found in Jesus Christ at Calvary.
Glad and God has done anything for you. Good morning. Minister Lane will come and lead us in our morning scripture.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
This is indeed the day that the Lord has made. Our scripture is going to come from Ephesians, the fourth chapter, verses 11 through 16. And today we're going to rely on our pew Bible, as the screen does not appear to be working, because even though God has given us technology and it sometimes fails, we know that God never fails. So this morning we're going to use our pew Bibles, or the Bible that you brought with us. I'm going to give you a little time to find it. It's Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. We thank God for being in the house that he has given us.
Praise the Lord.
Now that we all have the scripture, is everybody ready?
Amen.
Let us read together. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro, and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love. We must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us remain standing as we sing to our God and our Savior, how firm a foundation, how firm a foundation. You will also have to refer to it. No, we have it on the screen. Thank God. How firm a foundation. Hymn number 146. Let us now sing to the glory of God.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. You may be seated as we go to the Lord for a word of prayer. Amen. Bless your name, God. Amen. 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 Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for another opportunity to come into your house and worship your holy name, God. God, you are a good God. You are merciful. You are kind. You are a way maker. You are a healer, God. You've been all those things to us all throughout the week, and we've come to this point in our week to worship you, God, to worship you in spirit and truth, to worship you for all the things that you are. We worship you with our whole hearts on this day, Lord, and we thank you for an opportunity to worship. God, have your way in this place. Manifest yourself in this place. Show yourself to your people in this place, Lord. Lord, heal in this place. Deliver in this place and set free in this place. Save a soul in this place, Lord. Use us for your glory in this place. Use the ushers, Lord. Use the choir, Lord, to sing your songs of Zion, God, and to give you praise, Lord. Use the pianist and use the drummer. But most of all, God, we pray that you would use the preacher, Lord. Bless him, God, with the word from on high, Lord. Use him for your glory, God. Strengthen him, God, so that he can stand firm and proclaim all that you've given him to proclaim, God. God, be glorified. Manifest yourself in this place, Lord. Have your way, God, in this place. And let the people praise you, God, in the midst of everything that they have going on. Let them not be distracted, God, by their problems and by their worries and situations. But let the people praise you, Lord. And we thank you. And all these things we ask in that name that is above every name. That name that that saves and heals, God, and feeds us. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Thank God for
the spirit of hospitality to welcome our first-time guests. So if you were here worshiping with us at Mount Olive for the first time, would you please stand? Amen. 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 On behalf of our pastor, the Reverend Dr. James E. Victor, we are so grateful that you came to worship with us this morning. The Spirit is moving in this place, and we pray that it rests on you. So praying that God has his way in this place and in your life on today. And we thank you for coming visiting us today. For those who are worshiping with us online, we also welcome you also in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. If you are ever in the DMV area, we invite you to Arlington, Virginia to come worship with us in person. Now, Mount Olive, let us meet and greet each other as we meet and greet our guests. Amen.
Yes. Good morning, Mount Olive.
Good morning.
We are celebrating the pastor's birthday.
Anniversary
today of 15 years with us. Yeah. God has been so good to us. We just celebrated 144 years of existence. Now we're celebrating 15 years of having Reverend Victor as our president. 16 years. But we would be remiss if we did not say thank you to Mrs. Victor also. So Mrs. Victor, will you come up? Tell Mrs. Victor, we love her so much. She is just, her spirit is just beautiful. It is just beautiful. And the things that she does around the church and the people that she talks to, she always has a smile on her face. And she's a very caring individual. So, you know, God has blessed us with a beautiful first lady also. So we thought we would just give Mrs. Victor a small token from the Mount Olive Baptist Church and say thank her, thank you, thank you, thank you. We love you so much.
Many of you already know I'm a person of few words, but I love you all as well. Thank you.
Brother Pastor, come down, please. I got the floor now. You know, through it all, I love that song. See, I shout on that song, Rodney. I like that song. I want you to play something when I finish, please. Little thing means a lot. And working with my brother and my pastor over the last 16 years, I can tell you as your chairman, he's a hard-working man.
Yeah.
Now let me say this. Let me finish. The thing that Brother Pastor does, that I know, and you put me here as your chairman, and God has blessed me, we didn't have a pastor, and when he came along, I said, thank you, Jesus. But I know the ins and outs. And And Reverend Victor is a man that give his order and he'll take advice from his subordinate. He would do that. He visits the sick and shut-in. He's at the hospital and one of the members of ready to transfer on to glory. All these things you all doesn't see what Brother Pastor does. But I know because I work with him 100% of the time. The deacons respect him. The trustee respect him. And the church respect him.
Yeah. Amen.
And I know that.
Amen.
We have seen Mount Olive have grown.
Amen.
In the last 15 plus years under his leadership.
We have
witnessed the things that you, Brother Pastor, have done. And another thing about our pastor, he don't want you to praise him for this and that. He's just cool, calm, and collected. But let me say this to you. I had a visitor came down to Fellowship Hall, and Pastor Victor, he did the eulogy for her mother. And she said, he's down here serving us. Every repast, you could find our pastor serving the family and their guests.
Amen.
She said, I haven't seen this in my church, in any church I go to. I said, that's our pastor. Amen. Brother Pastor, we love you. We respect you. And we want to continue to pray that God continue to bless you, give you the strength and the knowledge that you need to lead this great church.
Amen.
And you are doing that.
Amen.
And through it all, I learned to trust in Jesus. And I learned to trust in God. Through it all. And I can shout because I know God's going to be with us for 16 more years. I don't know whether I'll be here. If not, I'll be up there. Smile.
Ooh. the church say amen. Mount Olive is preaching time. I am delighted and excited to introduce our preacher for this morning. He is the Reverend Xavier Johnson, and for the last 5 years, he has pastored the historic Bethel Missionary Baptist Church of Dayton, Ohio. But he is a friend of our former assistant pastor, Dr. Asa J. Lee, who thought he was gonna hide out in the balcony this morning and not get spotted. I've had the privilege of working with our preacher for today. As I told you a while ago, we were charged with developing a position paper on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And I have discovered him to be a gentleman of keen intellect, of insightful authority, and just a grand spirit. And so we want to welcome Reverend Xavier Johnson this morning as we celebrate 16 years. I don't know where they got 15 years from. I don't want to get cheated. Them been some rough years. 16 years as pastor and people. So Mount Olive, let's stand and give Reverend Johnson a warm Mount Olive welcome as he comes to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. The choir is going to sing as they prepare our hearts to receive the word of God. And then you will hear God's anointed preacher, the Reverend Xavier Johnson. Hear ye him. Thank you.
give God some praise. Come on, I think we can do a little bit better than that. You put your hands together and give God some praise. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. We say grace to you and peace from God, our Creator, Jesus, who is our Christ, and the Holy Spirit, who is our Comforter. You say it's indeed good to be back at the Mount Olive Church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And it's especially good to be here on such an auspicious occasion, the occasion of the 16th anniversary of your pastor. Can we celebrate he and his wife one more time? You know, it's good to go and to see how churches celebrate the gift that God has given them.
The gift.
You know, that's what y'all read in Ephesians today. The Bible says that the pastor is one of the gifts that God gives to the church. And so we thank God for him and for his ministry here among you. We bring you greetings from the Bethel Baptist Church in Dayton, Ohio, where I serve as pastor. And we're just privileged to be here. Don't want to take too long. I want to do something that I call Amen, Hurry Up Preaching. That means is if you say amen, I'll hurry up and preach. Now, if you don't say amen, and I don't think you understand what I'm talking about, then I got to elongate the sermon for sufficient time for you to understand, all right? But if you say amen, oh, yeah, we're going to be out of here in a few minutes. Dr. Victor has already acknowledged the presence of my best friend in the world. He's in the balcony. They used to say of Sam Proctor and Gardner Taylor that they knew enough about each other. Uh-huh. That between the two of them, they probably both ought to be hung at sundown. And so since we both know a lot about each other, I'll just say that it is good to see my friend this morning. Let us go to the Word of God. The Gospel of John, the 12th chapter. I want to look at verses 20 and 21. You all have to forgive me. I've been to seminary and I know about all the translations and everything, but I just like the way this sounds in the King James. Amen. So I'm going to read it in King James, if that's all right with you. Amen. Text says, and there were certain Greeks among them, beginning at verse 20, that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Text says, the same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And just for a few minutes, I want to talk about that last clause. You may be seated. Sir, we would see Jesus. Shall we pray? Father, we give you thanks and we give you praise for this moment that you have caused us by your grace to share together with one another. Now, Lord, we pray the prayer of that old Anglican hymn and ask that what we know not, you would teach us. That what we have not, you would give us. That what we are not, by your grace, you would make us. For the sake of Jesus, who is our crucified Christ and lynched Lord, we pray. Amen. The Reverend Dr. Gardner Calvin Taylor, that prince of preachers who was considered to be the dean of the American pulpit, delivered the Lyman Beecher lectures at Yale Divinity School in 1975. Those lectures were later compiled and published in a book titled, How Shall They Preach? In the fourth lecture, Preaching the Whole Counsel of God, Taylor says something very interesting about preaching, very interesting about the gospel, very interesting about preaching the gospel. Taylor says, the gospel of the Son of God, the word that the creation is built on, the lines of a cruciform and which was once and for all historicized at Calvary, is the answer to the questions that haunt and plague the human spirit. Taylor recognized something that I think would be helpful for us to recognize as we approach this great, grand, and glorious passage this morning found in the Gospel of John. And that is simply this, my sisters and my brothers, that the answer to every question that haunts and plagues humanity can be found in Jesus Christ at Calvary. Now, I thought I would get at least three more amens right there. See, the truth of the matter is that whether they know it or not, every human being is looking for Jesus. Because Jesus is God's answer to humanity. People want to see Jesus. The world is looking for Jesus, and it is the church's job to introduce him to them. Let me see if I can make this a little plainer for you. See, there are people in the world, there are people in your life,
right,
who are looking for Jesus. And they are depending on you to make the introduction. Yeah. Listen, if you don't get nothing else out of the sermon, write that down, tweet that, post that on Facebook. There are folk in your life who are looking for Jesus. And they need you to make the introduction. That's what's happening in our text. Folks are looking for Jesus.
Right.
And somebody who knows Jesus makes the introduction.
My Lord.
Jesus is back in Jerusalem. His eyes fixed on Calvary. They've just concluded an impromptu parade thrown in his honor. I wish I had some Bible readers here. The main thoroughfare of the city was lined with people waving palms and celebrating his arrival. Without the help of ushers, a processional is formed. Without the leadership of a director or the assisting accompaniment of an organist, a choir is assembled, and an anthem is sung. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And then, verse 20 says something quite interesting. It says, and there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And I think we just ought to pause and pitch our tent right there. Because this is a strange salutation. How is it that we find in this text the rare peculiarity of some unknown Greeks talking to a Galilean who they don't know, by the way, demanding of him that he introduce them to another Galilean who they also don't know? Yeah, your Bible says that there are Greeks in Jerusalem there to worship during the feast of the Passover. And that's important because that means that these fellas, these Greeks, these Gentiles are God-fearers. That means that they are Gentiles who have converted in a way to Judaism. These Greeks were Gentiles who worshiped the God of Israel. Yeah, and still, this is a strange way to say hello. As a matter of fact, it would be considered downright rude if you ask me. I don't know you. And you didn't introduce yourself. They didn't say, what's up?
Right.
How you doing?
Right.
You feeling all right today? Hi, my name is Johnson. Now, they didn't say anything that they belay with all of the normal niceties that people usually go through, especially when they don't know someone. They cut straight to the point. Sir, we would see Jesus. Listen again to their request. Sir, we would, sir, take us to Jesus. Look at the structure of their request. They didn't ask Philip to take them to Jesus.
Right.
The verse 21 in your Bible, that last phrase is not an interrogative. It's a declarative.
Right.
Matter of fact, I would even go as far to say that if such a phrase exists, it is an imperative declarative phrase.
Right.
Correct. Yes. These men are not asking Philip to take them to Jesus. They are demanding.
Sir,
we would.
Right.
See, I don't care what he's doing. I don't care where he is.
Right.
I don't care how far we got to go to get there. And I don't care what you're doing. Because I didn't say, excuse me. I just said, sir.
Right. Right.
Stop. Oh, child of God, listen. The reason this is important is because this is the conscious and unconscious cry of unredeemed humanity.
My God.
Sir, ma'am, we would see Jesus. These words that we find being uttered here from the lips of these unnamed, unknown Greeks in the text are today still being screamed and shrieked, whimpered and whispered from the lips of those who would see Jesus today and don't know how to get to it. This is important to know. It's important to recognize because we, the church, the redeemed, the blood bought and the blood washed. Yeah, uses. Those who are saved and sanctified. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Uses. We have an obligation. We have a duty. We have an inherent responsibility that is uniquely and unitarily ours. And that's simply to introduce folks to Jesus.
Oh, I know. You thought, yeah, I know. I know. I hear you. I hear what you're talking about. What you mean? That's my job. That's the pastor's job. Don't you see it say, sir?
No, ma'am. No, sir. It is all of our job and the singular striving of the church ought to be to introduce people to Jesus. It is our sole responsibility to get folk to know Jesus. And what I like about the text, Minister Jones, I'm looking here at the text, and there's an assumption made in the text. The men who approach Philip somehow know that he knows Jesus. Y'all shouting on the wrong thing, though. Because they assume that because he knows Jesus, he can introduce them to Jesus. Look, scoot over for a minute. Can I tell you something? Listen, let me sit next to you. I'm going home in a few minutes. Listen, let me tell you. There are people in your life who don't know Jesus, but they know you. And they are waiting on you. They are depending on you. They are looking for you to introduce them to Jesus. And the only reason they ain't met him yet is because you ain't made the introduction. That's the truth about the matter. The truth is that it's our job. It's the job of us who know Jesus to introduce Jesus to those who don't. And you didn't close your Bible on me, did you? You still got it open? Because I want you to look at something. Look back in your Bible. I don't want you to say it's my Bible. Look in your Bible. I want you to look at it. Look at verse 20 and 21. Look at it. Look at it close. Get your magnifying glass out. Get your trifocal out. Get your monocle out. Look at your Bible. And I want you to notice something in text. Read them first two verses again. Read them to yourself. Read them. All right, go ahead. There it is. Now notice something. I want you to notice that Philip was by himself when these unknown men rolled up on him. And that's really what they did. They just rolled up on him. He wasn't with the other 11 disciples. He wasn't even standing next to Jesus. He was alone, and I don't even think he had his Mount Olive Baptist Church t-shirt on. And yet, there was something about him that said to folk who didn't even know him that he knew Jesus. I see about five folk got it. Listen, lean in a little closer. Can I say something else to you? That's your question? You know, I don't mean no harm, but is there something about you that tells others that you know Jesus? No. I'm not talking about you walking around with your family-sized Bible with the holographic picture of black dreadlock Jesus on the front. No. I'm not talking about you walking around with a gold cross around your neck. No, I'm not talking about whether or not your radio or your iPhone is constantly set to gospel. Or whether or not when somebody asks you how you're doing, you look up and say, oh, I'm blessed and highly favored. Look, you got to tell you a secret. And this means, this comes from a preacher, okay? Let me tell you something. See, those things are surface. Those things are superficial and superfluous, and in some cases, to be honest, they're downright annoying. I'm just trying to help somebody. See, being a Christian, knowing Jesus is not about holding a Bible in your hands. It's about having the Word made flesh down in your heart. Being a Christian is not about wearing a cross around your neck. It's about picking your cross up, putting your cross on your shoulder, and bearing you. And people ought to be able to look at you and see that you know Jesus. Well, some might say, well, you know, Philip was a Greek. Could be that Philip, being a Galilean of Greek extraction, looked Greek. And since these other guys are Greek, that's why they approached him looking for Jesus. Quote, Mr. from the Color Purple, could be not. Who's to say? I think it's something deeper than that. There was something about Philip that clued others in to the fact that he knew Jesus. Something about him said that he knew the Savior. Oh, child of God, there ought to be something about you that lets others know that you know Jesus. No, it's not your words, it's your walk. Your life ought to be a testimony to the good news of the gospel of the Son of God. Your life ought to be a love letter to the lost. People should meet you and smell the sweet savor of the Savior. Folk ought to look at you and say, if Jesus can do it for them, I know he can do it for me. If Jesus can keep them, I know that he can keep me. If Jesus can change them, oh, I wish I had some church folk here. I know we're sitting in Mount Olive and it's first Sunday morning and we getting ready to take communion, but somebody ought to be able to testify that I ain't always been saved. I ain't always been in the church. I ain't always been sitting here on a Sunday morning looking edumacated and sophisticated. God had to bring me somewhere. Jesus changed my, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus. Whether or not you're inside the church or outside, there ought to be something about you. There ought to be something different about you. There ought to be a glow about you that draws folks not to you, but to Jesus. And that's because Jesus is God's solution. Jesus is God's answer to all of humanity's questions. In him and him alone is the satisfaction, is the safety, is the security that all of us are seeking. Okay, come here, Augustine, help me testify. Augustine said in his confessions that you have made us for yourself. And our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. I got news for somebody. I don't mean no harm, but Jesus does not have the solution. Jesus does not just have the answer to humanity's problems. Jesus is the answer to humanity's problems. Because if you jump down to verse 32, I'm ready to cut across the road now. The record says that when these unknown Greeks came to Philip with their demand to see Jesus, that Philip went and got his brother Andrew. And that they together went down to where Jesus was. And they took the request that they had received from these unknown Greeks, these God-fearers. And that after hearing their request, Jesus said these words to them and to all who were in the sound of his voice. You know what he said, don't you? He said, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, shall draw all men unto me. The hymn writer asked the question, how to reach the masses, men of every birth. For an answer, Jesus gave the key. He said, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, the world is hungry. I wish I had some church folk here for the living bread. Lift the Savior up for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. I'll draw all men unto me. Don't exalt the preacher. Don't exalt the pew. Preach the gospel, simple, full, and free. Prove him, and you'll find that the promise is true. I'll draw all men unto me. And look, this is my favorite verse. And I done messed around, got happy. Let go, good God, come on. Lift him up by living like a Christian ought. Let the world in you the Savior see. Then men, women, boys and girls, Nook Nook, Big Steve, Keisha them, then they'll gladly follow him once who once taught. I'll draw all men unto me. I gotta leave you now, Mount Olive. May the Lord God bless you real good. It's been real nice being here. But I just got one question for you. Is there anybody here who knows that Jesus still got drawing power? Is there anybody here who can testify that if you just lift him, he'll do the drawing? Is there anybody here who don't mind testifying that Jesus still has saving power, that Jesus still has redeeming power? Is there anybody here who knows that God is still saving? God is still rescuing. And all we gotta do is we gotta lift him. We gotta lift him until broken hearts get healed. We gotta lift him until troubled minds are soothed. We gotta lift him until wounded spirits are made whole. We've gotta lift him until hatred turns to love. We gotta lift him until bitterness turns to forgiveness. We've got to lift him until despair turns to hope. Is there anybody here who knows we got to lift him to broken homes are healed, lift him to fractured families are put back together, lift him to wayward children come home? We've got to lift him until the heroin addict puts down her needle. We've got to lift him until the crack addict puts down his pipe. We've got to lift him until the alcoholic puts down the bottle. Lift him up. Lift him up. Still he speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw.
Thank you.
there one today, after having heard the Savior and seen the Savior lifted in embodiment, in the embodiment of the preacher, who would now want to be connected through the ministry of magnetism to the one that the preacher extols as the answer to humanity's greatest questions. Jesus is the scratch to the itch that no one else can reach. So if you are here today, man, woman, boy, or girl, it matters not who you might be, what you have done. He's still drawing, not to the preacher, not even to the church, but Christ is drawing those who should be saved unto himself. So if you are here, we extend the invitation to Christian discipleship. You may come by the ways commonly known among Baptists. If you've never been baptized before, we invite you to come to publicly acknowledge the inner relationship that you have with the Christ. There may be others that are looking for a church home where you can be groomed and grown for ministry. We invite you to come by letter or by Christian experience. Doesn't matter how you come, all of us had to come some kind of way. All of us came through something. All of us have done something that we regret. But the blood still works. And it still has power to attract. And so if you are here this day, it's a wonderful day to get right with God and do it now. As the choir sings, the invitation is still extended. Is there one that would come and unite themselves with the Christ and then become a part of his body, the church? If you're here, won't you come?